academic and its theater, the place where they both meet.
You have the audience and the participants for each other.
The initial practice is the start of practice is cultural practice.
Examples of women
sharing what it is that you do, sharing how you do that.
There's no way you can ignore Latinos anymore.
We're from all around the world. You can come and see and talk about
it. What time is it now in Kenya?
It started out about different people and about different things.
A whole sea of phenomena.
Theater for everybody. Yes, everybody.
That's just what should be done.
It has to be completely open.
And indeed, my understanding of life, relationships, death
has already changed.
So welcome, everybody, to the Martin E. Siegel Theater Center here, the Graduate Center. CUNYs, thank you all for taking time out in your busy life. It's getting closer to the Christmas time. I know how it is in New York, but to come to us and share an evening. We really take pride in what we do and the presentations really from all around the world, but once in a while we feel it's a even more special evening than all the other ones. And I think one of them is today, and tonight we have with us the great Robert Lepage, who's over there, who is working in New York City at the moment at the Met Opera. We will talk a bit about it. I don't know how it happened. There was a lapse in the time warp or something, but it happened that he could come to us for an hour and a half, and it's really a really, really, really great honor for us to have him here in the world of chess. We have now two chess masters, grandmasters playing, but Robert Lepage is a grandmaster of theater, and his extraordinary work, his also big output, as I think Susan Sontag said, you see, you know, a great master in any field, you see also about the amount of output, creative work that's been done, is stunning. And today we got a little insight in it. We saw him perform in a film he also directed that was The Dark Side of the Moon, that also was a theater play before, and then a film he directed, Triptych. We saw The Image Mill, a great projection project in the city of Quebec for celebrating 400 years, which he created. So, and this is just a truly a little insight into his work. So I really encourage you all to go and see his work. He's going to come to BAM next to the opera, of course, which will be here next spring. He will be here. And we hope to inspire you, and but also learn a bit from him about what it means to be an artist, how, why we do theater, why we tell stories, and what we do. And truly, it's a great privilege to be in the same space, in the same room with Robert Lepage, and instead of seeing something just on the screen or something. So that's why theater is so fantastic. The Siegel Center bridges academia and professional theater, international and American theater. And this right fits in what we do. And if you look a little bit at our lineup, as it fits in the voices from all around the world, we often feel we don't hear enough from Canada. We don't hear enough also from the great region of Quebec. It's so close. It's much closer sometimes than a bad ride to Pittsburgh or Washington. Still, the voices don't come over here, and something has happened. We mentioned it before, perhaps after 9/11, but this is, we are really neighbors, and we need to, especially after the last week's events, we really know how important it is to listen, to be close, and to be inclusive, and to open it up. And we will also talk a little bit about the art center, Le Diamant, which Robert is creating in Quebec, that hopefully might also help to bridge what is so close, but somehow seems also so distant. Quebecois playwrights, we just had them also here, three of them, good, very good plays. They are sometimes better known in Paris or in London or in Berlin than they are here in New York, and it's just shocking, and it shouldn't be like this. We also would like to thank very much CEAD, the Centre des Écrivains Artistiques Dramatiques, if I said it right, who really helped us. Also, we really want to thank you and Emmanuel Hatter, helping hands to get Robert also with us. And Emmanuel was a visiting scholar a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, at the Segal Theater Center. And so this also helped for us, you know, to open up. And she hopefully liked her time here and said, you know, I could maybe help you to bring some more playwrights and others over here. So thank you so much. The format of the evening will be Emmanuel will give us a little overview. Again, it's an excerpt of the work of Robert Lepage, so we know a little bit more what it is, what he's doing. Then we will have a talk. Mostly we will listen to Robert, and then we have a really also a good amount of time reserved for a question, a Q&A with the audience. We need good theater, but we also need a really good audience, and I think you are a great audience. Often we have, you know, good people here and smart people here, so this is an open dialogue. And thank you again all for coming, and I now ask Emmanuel to give us a bit more insight in the work of Robert. Thank you.
Hello. First of all, I would like to thank the Segal Center again and highlight their amazing work, especially when it comes to creating bridges between the academic and performing arts communities. My name is Emmanuel Sirois. I am currently the advisor and curator for international projects at the Centre des Auteurs Dramatiques, CEAD, a playwright center based in Montreal. I feel very, very honored to introduce Robert Lepage Theatre tonight. Like most theatre artists and theorists of my generation, I discovered Robert Lepage in the early 2000s. For many of us, the encounter with his shows was significant, because they are astonishing, impressively beautiful, but also because it has allowed a generation of Francophone Quebecois to dream, breathe, and tell their stories outside of ideological discourses on identities and project themselves in the world. Robert Lepage is a very prolific, multidisciplinary artist born in the city of Quebec. He first made his mark at the theater as author, director, and actor in a collective called Repère. He has created numerous projects, among which they are Vinci, the Dragon Trilogy, the Needles and Opium, the Seven Streams of the Rivière Ota, the Far Side of the Moon, the Geometry of Miracles, and the Anderson Project, to name a few. One of the most important cultural figures on the international scene, Robert Lepage has also explored cinema, museum, exhibitions, rock shows and operas, circus, multimedia projects such as Bibliothèque, Library, as virtual exploration of 10 of the world's most fascinating libraries, and the Image Mill, a huge outdoors historical multimedia show. His works have been translated into several languages and sometimes contain more than one at a time on stage. It is a question of taking languages also as artistic object, he reminded us during an interview, and stage them in order to make them resonate differently, to divert objects from their function, to find a poetic charge, and to reveal the infinite ambiguity of the world by games of transparency constantly renewed. I felt this poetic charge the first time when I saw The Far Side of the Moon, and Fatal when I saw Squeals, his production on the Marquis de Sade, where multiple mirrors were used to transition from one scene to another, and also to confront the spectator with his own monster. Just like Sade did his outrageous characters. I felt this powerful rush more recently with 887, his last performance, where, in my opinion, miniature models highlighted the fragility of memory. Ludovic Fouquet tells us in a book on Robert Lepage, The Horizon in Images, that his work is in perpetual invention and evolution. This is especially due to his ability to integrate other forms of art, such as photography, cinema, video, and music. But this is also embodied in the unfolding and recombination of DNA, the process of creation, itself often composed from improvisation. Creation from contrast is also important in the Lepage Theater. He said it is the paradoxes in the work of Da Vinci that first interested him. The contradictions and the duality in The Far Side of the Moon is reflected in the incongruities of the Anderson Project's constant opposition between the past and the present. In 887, his most the narrative unfolds by creating relations between his own life and the history of Quebec. The light of Lepage's creativity emerged from the thoughtful construction or reconstructions of the tensions that plague us today. In this way, Lepage's approach itself offers a series of mutating contrasts which provide a rich source for contemporary inspiration. It is often said of Lepage that he is a master of the theater of images and unfold technology within his mise-en-scène. But the use of technology remains motivated, first of all, by the meaning of the narrative and a high degree sensitivity to the various forms by which it can be expressed. As he himself explained in an interview with the playwright Carole Fréchette at the beginning of 1987, "I have no shyness in integrating technology. It opens path and constitutes a new language." Likewise, Fouquet tells us, "Lepage thinking evolves from the theoretical space to the theoretical image, an image understood as the surface of representation. From the fusion of the viewer's gaze and the theatrical thought of the creator, there is developed during the show a shared language that gives an enrichment to the stage within unprecedented semantics. These enriching semantics span not just on the stage, but also, as I want to suggest, the trajectory and cultural store of innovation Lepage has bequeathed to us. They touch on every element of what, in the broadest sense, can be thought contemporary dramaturgy. Other important dimensions of Lepage's work are undoubtedly the journey, the call of mystery, and the aesthetics of ambiguity. Ambiguity as a dramaturgic power, the passage from one place to another, metaphorically speaking, but also in terms of the scenographic strategies employed and the mutations from one referential framework to another. In this sense, I want to highlight just one of Robert Lepage's most recent projects, namely his creation of a unique cultural venue, Le Diamant, located in Quebec City and dedicated to the presentation of local and international creations. It will be a variable geometric venue that will accommodate shows with large deployments in an intimate setting, the Diamond, Le Diamant. The name of this place offers us a gateway into the dense work of Lepage. He takes in cultural resources, not in the matter of appropriation, but in the matter of distilling their constitutive horizon, deconstructing their narrative, spaces, and strategies, and ambiguously recombining, recoding their positions, not only for the local audience, but no less for international audience. Indeed, beside the fact of being multifaceted, the main property of the diamonds is its work on light. The diamond can reflect light, refract, decompose, or disperse it. If a beam of white light is projected through a diamond, and if a screen is placed in front of the refracted rays, one can see a display of color similar to that of the sky. I very sincerely thank Robert Lepage for his audacity, his finesse, and his light. And I wish you a very nice evening. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for coming. Thank you, Emmanuel, for giving us a little overview. I think from the images in the back, you could just see a bit of that stunning theater. This is just the visual material without the connection to the narrative, which is so significant also in your work. So, Robert, first of all, again, really thank you for coming. It really means the world.
Great pleasure being here.
Really means the world for us. What are you working on at the moment at the Met?
Well, I'm in New York for a few weeks because we are restaging a production of L'Amour de Loin by Kaija Saariaho. It's a contemporary piece of opera that was created in year 2000. And so we're restaging because it's a co-production between my company, Ex Machina, and the Met. And we've been doing this through a few projects. Most of the stuff we present here at the Met is co-produced by our small company in Quebec City.
And so we're doing this, it's starting the 1st of December, so and there's still a lot of tickets left. And it's a very, very exciting project. She's a writer, a composer from Finland, and the libretto was written by Amin Malouf, which is one of the great French Lebanese writers, who's very much interested and obsessed by the idea of crusades and, of course, the Arab world versus the Western world. So it's quite a wonderful piece of music and of narrative, actually.
So how does it feel being a Quebecois artist, being in New York working? Mm-hmm. Do you feel at home?
Yes, I feel at home because the Quebecois culture it's difficult to define exactly what it is because we're francophones. Most of us are francophones in Quebec. It's the French-speaking province of Quebec, though there are other French-speaking people across Canada. But French is pretty much the basis of what distinguishes Quebec's culture, but also because of our French past, because there once were people from France who founded Canada, and eventually the Brits came and kicked them out, but we remained French in Quebec. So we've adopted the British view and the British way of life. So we're French from France, we're British, you know, we're part of the British Empire, but we're also very American. Because we're next door neighbors and we're part of North America and we were all brought up by, at least in the 20th century, most of Quebec artists have watched Batman and Bewitched, and I mean, we're complete American television culture. So our way of life is very, very American. So, and I think that for a long time that was probably a bit of a complex thing to express when you don't really know who you are. And with time, I think Quebecers understood that it was actually a plus. There was something there in the fact that we're a very young nation, where a very young culture, where everything is to be defined and determined. So there's a lot of space for artists who want to experiment and contribute to try to find what is Quebec identity. And so it's a very, very, I think, very open-minded and very open. And because of the fact that we speak French in this sea of English-speaking people in North America and within our own country, because we're a minority in a certain sense, because there's for 34 or 35 million Canadians, maybe 8 to 9 million of them speak French. So in order to survive that, we have to create a kind of a star system within our own borders in Quebec. But if we want to export our culture, there is a language barrier. So of course we go to France, and our poets and writers and singers go to France a lot, and go to French-speaking countries like Belgium and many other countries. But if we want to come to the U.S. or if we want to be part of the world stage, the French language is a barrier. So what do you do besides surtitles? So that's why there's a very highly visual and physical theater, dance, culture in Quebec, and certainly circus. Cirque du Soleil is a Quebecois product, I'd say now, but pretty much and because I think that in the 70s and the 80s there was this consciousness in Quebec that if you wanted to be part of the world, if you wanted to be part of the world scene, if you wanted to be part of the dialogue with the rest of the world, French would sometimes be, as much as it's part of our culture, it's also an obstacle. So we've developed a theater that's more imagistic, physical, more about energy, movement, and so there's a lot of expertise that was developed in Quebec. A lot of the new high-tech developments come from Quebec more and more. I mean, so there's this thing that happened that made our culture much more, not multimedia, but pluridisciplinary, I'd say, in order to survive.
Yeah, that it is really true, and also the work in it's 360 in VR and the domes you have. The great Italian film director and writer Pasolini, who I admire also very much, he once said, you want to be an artist, you have to throw your body into life. Mm-hmm. And it's dangerous. And it, for him, actually, it was very, very dangerous. And most probably, as it comes out now, was killed by the police. But you, in a way, you also took your life. You threw it into theater. Mm-hmm. Why did you choose theater? Why? Because you move in so many.
Well, because
art
it was
forms.
The only thing around that I could afford. I mean, of course, now film is more of affordable. I mean, there's some amazing film directors coming out of Quebec now, and there are other means of expression, of course. But I'd say that theater was the poor man's expression in the 60s, certainly in the 70s. People who could not afford writing a novel and finding a publisher would write a play. Somebody who could not afford doing film because it's too expensive or whatever would produce a play. So the play is a kind of, theater was a kind of a refuge place, at least in French-speaking Canada, for all the people who wanted to do something else in life. But theater seemed to offer a quick pass, you know, to have access to the audiences. And then certainly my interest in theater did not come from theater.
Where did it
came
start?
From theatricality. And what I mean by that is that theater was, when I was very young, was something for the bourgeoisie. And my family wasn't part of the bourgeoisie. We were, we were not a poor family, but we weren't a family that could afford going to the theater. So the only theater that I would be in contact with was rock theater. Or, there was a theatrical rock, or there was a when Pina Bausch came about, was dance theater. And she pretty much coined that dance theater thing, And suddenly people like Laurie Anderson and the whole performing arts clique of New York who would be visual artists or music artists who would use theatricality to get their stories across. So I was very interested in the fact that theater was not just something that was used by theater people. And actually, the people who used theater and who were not actors or not writers were much more interesting storytellers, well, to my taste. So I was always very interested in theatricality, not thinking that theater would actually be my thing. But I remember seeing the first, the early days of progressive rock, where you would have people like Jethro Tull and Gentle Giant and Genesis, who would come on stage and they'd be dressed as characters, medieval characters, and they'd have sets, and the songs weren't crafted for these 2.5 minutes on the radio. You'd have 25-minute long stories with characters and dialogue, and it was all this thing. So I remember, being brought up when I was a very young teenager, I'd go to see these rock shows, and these people would put on these amazing plays, basically. And of course, one of the most influential one was Peter Gabriel, who was the lead singer of Genesis at the time, and who would work with mask, and who would actually do a lot of mime and pantomime, so all of that pulled me towards the aesthetics of theater. Of course, I was very disappointed when I auditioned for the conservatory in Quebec City. I was accepted, and of course, all these people were doing
as an actor.
Yeah. And I was a bit disappointed because nobody was doing Peter Gabriel stuff. And I was 17, and I was going, we have to learn these long Racine things and Chekhov, for God's sakes, So a lot of very almost melodramatic, theater that was hyper-naturalistic stuff that I wasn't interested at all. So I put myself through the theater school and almost got kicked out 3 times because all the time I spent there, I would spend more time trying to follow what directors were doing or set designers were doing, or any invited teacher would be more interested because they would come in with their aesthetics and their ideas and their... the teachers wanted to kick me out because I wouldn't spend enough time working on my acting, and I'd be too much interested in doing sound editing or whatever was available at the time. So when I came out of theater school, I was sure that, you know, there was an, I would never have a career. So I never tried to have a career, and I didn't have any ambition to be either an actor. I was just more interested in any kind of craft that was around theater. So that's why I got interested in directing, and but at the same time designing, and why not write a bit, and why not direct, and why not maybe act a bit, and you know. So I never put myself through any auditions or tried to, you know, have an answering machine at home in case some agent would call, and you know, I was that thing, that reality didn't belong to me. I was much more into trying to create some kind of event. That was my thing.
So you kind of created a collective. You were a bunch of friends, or pretty, college,
pretty
or
much
how
because
did it start?
I've always been a very, very shy person. And the paradox, of course, you know, I don't know why we paint ourselves in the corner all the time, because we're very shy, and we end up being, you know, the spokesperson for a group, or we ended up being the director or the leader of a band or whatever. So the shy people always end up in front. But what I liked about theater is that I had tried all sorts of other disciplines before, you know, arts, music, and all that. And it was very, very exposing, because you would be standing there with your classical guitar, and you'd have to play, and, you know, you'd be very exposed. But theater was a great thing, because it was a gang, you know, it was a bunch of people, and you could hide behind the group, but still be part of the thing, still be creative. And if ever it flopped, well, it was the director's fault, you know. He'd take the flak, but you were part of the group in the event and all that. So I kind of, that's why I was interested. So that's why the collective thing and the idea of doing a lot of collective creation, which was very in at that time, for me, was quite interesting, because you could hide within that. You didn't have any real responsibility. You had, you know, the group had a responsibility, so you could, you know, exchange and but there was a lot of compromise, though. That's the only frustrating part of creative. You know, you'd be sitting around saying, okay, we're doing a show about war, so we all agree that war is not a good thing. But of course, we all came from different backgrounds, and we all had, you know, different social classes, and some of us were men, some of us were women. You know, we had so many things that we were so different. So of course you'd have to put a lot of water in your wine all the time, because that's not really what you want to say. But of course, if we say it my way, it's going to frustrate this person, and this person's not going to feel represented. So anyways, this whole creation collective thing became a bit of a bore, because it's nice to see a group of people trying to express something, but if it's a half-baked idea, it's of no interest. So I was struggling for a long time to try to find a way to continue to work in a collective way, but that the work would not be a compromise, that actually the addition or the combination of different creators would actually be a plus and not a watered-down version of the thing. So that took a while before I met the right people, and that I understood that there were maybe other ways of working collectively.
I like very much the idea, if I understood right, from the very first film we showed, The Backside of the Moon, where basically you play almost like a schizophrenic character, with like two mm-hmm. brothers, one who is the weatherman and, you know, doesn't even have to tell the truth, and people like, all seems easy, and the other guy who struggles, he writes a paper but doesn't get it done, and it's about cosmology and about space and how to get out there. And at the very end, you kind of see that, you know, he doesn't really get to do what he wants to do. He makes a little film as a message for extraterrestrial life, so they understand what it is he gets chosen. So the idea that the artist actually aims to something that goes out to space and is not tied to gravity, and that it's that you are a cosmonaut. Is that, do I see that right?
The thing is that, of course, when I write The Far Side of the Moon, I never wrote The Far Side of the Moon. I improvised it until it dried and became just a script, I guess. But the thing that I kind of discovered that as I was going along, that there was two sides to me. There was a side that was very much about integrity and message and, you know, purity and being sincere about stuff and being idealistic and all that. And there was a side of me who was a showman and was interested in showing off, you know. And how do you reconcile that? So it's a show about reconciliation. So it's about reconciliation, the Americans and the Russians, and then eventually becomes about reconciling these two brothers. But it was mainly something about reconciling these two things within me, about, you know, how do you... You know, we have very paradoxical personalities, and certainly writers or artists, we see our contradictions as problems, but actually they're a rich source of inspiration. You know, and I understood that only when I got to doing the Far Side of the Moon, and my interest was much more about, you know, the looking outward. And trying to understand, you know, well, what's up there, and, you know, is there some form of life? But not just the extraterrestrial thing. It's more, you know, is there a God up there? Or, you know, for me, the thought was much deeper than that. But it's a scary thought, and it gives you vertigo. You know, you become very dizzy if you're only looking upwards. So there has to be a part of you that also digs into the ground and is looking for a basis and something that will make you understand what goes on Earth. So we're always kind of navigating between these two points. So for me, it was a very liberating moment in my work where I understood that I could be an idealist and a dreamer, but at the same time, you're being very, very down to earth. You know, very.
So do you have a message to give? I mean, Jack Warner, the film producer, famously said, messages are for Western Union and not for us. But one feels you are communicating.
Well, this, for me, what's important is that artists in general, of course, you want to have a large audience and you want to be understood by as many people. For personal satisfaction and to feel that you're not alone with your little tragedy or whatever, but also because it's, you know, there's more money to be made if you have a big audience and a small audience. So for me, what was important was to do something, to embark into something that would be as seen by as many people as possible. And to that, people call that international theater. Everybody wants to be an international theater artist, and they want to be renowned internationally and all that. I mean, that's a false path to follow. What you want to do, you want to do something that's universal. And for me, the big difference is that if you want to be international, write in English, you know, make stuff where, change the names of this in the story, make sure that it takes place in a standard place that everybody recognizes or whatever. But that's like a wrong path. What you have to do is that you have to talk about what goes on in your own kitchen. Speak about what you know. And what you know is your very banal local life. Be extremely local. And the more local you are, the more universal you are. And that took a while for me to understand that. When I started doing that, it started to work out. And people start to get it. And it explains why at the Cannes Film Festival, it's always the Iranian film that gets the Palme d'Or, you know? You know, why is it that you see a film that takes place in Tehran and where it's a completely different set of values than our society, it's a completely different country, some women are veiled, the rules are not the same, people don't speak the same language as we do, they have a different history, you know, it's so radically different. But yet we cry and we feel and we recognize ourselves in their stories. So what is it? So the more local your story is, the more sincere, the more you know what you are talking about. You're not putting on a show about something, some other people's reality or whatever. Not that you should not be interested in other people's stories, but what I'm saying is that the more it's about you, the more you're going to have a large audience. So when I kind of understood that, then I could understand that when you tell a story, there's, in French, the word story is the same word as history. You see, we say histoire. L'histoire is history. Une histoire is a story. So for me, I always say you have to combine histoire with a small h, a lowercase h, I think you say in English, and histoire with a capital H. And the two echo each other. So when I work with a group of actors and we develop a story, or when I work on a solo show, I'm never preoccupied by the capital H. I trust that it will be there. So I talk about the small history. I talk about my history, about my local stuff, about my life in general. And it's really banal and of no interest. But I do that. And that I know very well. I know my life story. I know the story of my parents. I know my friends' stories, my close friends. I know very, very clearly why this happened and whatever. So I talk about that, and it's almost melodramatic, and it's of no interest. But I trust that if I do it well, and if I sculpt it well, that eventually this a larger thing, which is history with a capital H, that appears. And but you can't force that. You can't say, oh, I'm going to do this, and this is, people will be thinking of this historical event this that happened in the story of humanity. You know. It'll kind of show up by itself. So when I started touring, like a show like Far Side of the Moon, which is a very melodramatic story, you know, two brothers, the father's dead, the mother just died, they have to find, they're very different, they have to find a way to reconcile, you know. Very banal. And you play this story in a place like Korea, and they go wild. They love this thing. It's a huge, huge event in Seoul. And you know, why is that? Of course, they, for them, two brothers who are very different, who try to reconcile, can't find a way, it talks to them, speaks to them in a completely different way that's beyond your command, beyond your power. The only thing you could do is continue talking about this, you know, very banal story of you and your brother. And so that's why I'm interested in that. I'm interested in, and that can only happen if your work travels, if it's exposed to other audiences, if people abroad inject their own reality in what you do. And if you take that and you re-inject it into your piece, we did a piece, a very early piece called Dragon's Trilogy, and it was a bifrontal show. We had sand and we had bifrontal. It was very à la mode in those days to do bifrontal stuff. So we did this bifrontal show and all that. And there was a moment where we were trying to express the Second World War with Marines and army people who had skates, and they would do this kind of thing in the sand, and eventually it became the war because we had all these shoes and they were crushing the shoes. Anyways, it was a very devastating scene, and people were all crying, and it was a very, very, and the dry sand would start to go up in clouds, and it was very, very effective metaphor for what was going on in the war, while these lovers were actually kind of just skating around in couples and whatever. And in Poland, when we did this in Poland, it was a huge thing. And that scene was like people were crying. Blah, blah, blah. And we were wondering why it was such a big thing for them. And they say, well, because we know what it is to be attacked on both fronts. For suddenly the bifrontal thing had a reason why it was there. It had a meaning. So that's what I mean. Your work is informed by all these things that you don't have any idea, and that you don't have any experience, and you don't have any intention to inject that. But you have to take it in and learn from that and say, okay, well, that's why the work is universal. Because there's a place for these things to happen for people. It's not something I commanded. It's not something I envisioned. It's there. And your work has to be available for other people to make it resonate with their own stories and their own humanity.
Yeah, you just also now used the word to sculpt it. And I think in the image milieu, you use the example of the Inuit sculptor who has a stone, and he feels it's already inside. Is that how you feel? How do you develop your ideas?
Well, that's how I describe it.
Is it already, when you do a play, is it already there?
Yeah, the play, for example, there's about, 30, 40 people here today. Okay, let's say we do a collective thing. Of course, it would take more time than if we were five or six around a table, but still, let's say we do a collective thing. Even before we start, there's a story right now that's under these boards here. There's a show. It already exists. It has lines. It has characters. There's a subject matter. That already exists. And what exists is the combination of every people's experience and sensibility and sensitivity. Or it exists. So what we do, what my job would be to try to do all these different explorations and improvs and games and whatever to try to scratch the surface of this floor, and then eventually we would find, like archaeologists, we would suddenly go, oh, there's a line here between that, this person here and that person there, there's a connection, and okay, and we continue. And, but we don't know what it is, but it's like archaeology, you know, you just kind of dig, and suddenly you do a little 10 by 10 square, and you see that there's the wheel of some kind of vehicle, whatever. We don't know what the vehicle is. And then somebody else finds a little thing there. And then it, after only a few digs, we could see the whole ship that's dug under there. We didn't have to dig the whole thing. We just by a few hints, we okay, there's this. And then all the connections happen. So I believe in that. In that approach. And the thing about the Inuit sculpture is that that's how Inuit or Eskimo sculptors were. Not all, they don't all do Eskimo hunting scenes in soapstones for the tourists. You know, they have this kind of respect of, they take a whale bone and it would be just there by the shore, and they believe that the bone has a story, there's a sculpture already in it. They believe in that, and they just leave it there. And eventually the sun goes down, and the light rays, the sun rays, are in a certain angle that suddenly on the surface they see there's a forest there. And you could see the forest very well, you could see it, except for people to see it at other times of the day, they have to help it. So they kind of just help it. They just do as little interventions as they can on the bone. So then you see the forest, it's been there. And then some other day it starts raining and the bone, some parts become darker and some parts remain pale. And then you say, oh, there's an animal in the forest there. Look at that. And you can see an animal with some antlers, whatever, and they help that animal express itself. But they don't say, oh, I have an idea. I'm gonna do an animal with some antlers in a nice forest. And they take this, and they don't do that. They just respect what that thing. But of course, they're the ones seeing this. And it is an expression of the people who sculpt it. But they respect the basic material. So that's why that's how I see collective creation, or even solo shows. That's what I do. I start with something and I play around with it and whatever, and eventually there's this whole world that was just waiting for us to kind of help it and just kind of do a couple of lines here and to underline the presence of this or whatever, and eventually the thing will appear.
When you put something on stage, what is important to you?
Well, it's difficult to say, because actually I used to be, that's one of the problems that I have right now at the Met, is that I'm a director and I sit in a room and I direct and it has to look good and it has to work. I'm not really happy doing that. I do it. I think I'm okay at doing that. But I'm more interested when I'm on stage, when I'm directing from within, and what's on stage, and the choices that I make are more essential, and they're more. I'm not trying for it to look good, or to fit in the frame, or to. I feel it from. So that's why when we do creations, I like to be part of the creation. I like to be there as an actor, whatever. So I direct from within. I try to do that. But I'm interested in, there's many things through the years that I've kind of because I'm still wondering today, you know, why am I doing this instead of doing something that's easier? because it's not easy. But you know, there's this whole thing. We're all brought up, or we're all trained as actors when we go to theater schools or universities or whatever. People talk about emotion, you know, an actor, it's all about emotion and all that. But emotion is taught to us as something that's on stage amongst as actors, and the actress is working on her emotion, and she's expressing this emotion and communicating. They're doing this whole thing, and we're sitting in the room there as spectators, and we're going, oh, you know, we don't feel any emotion, but we could see it. We say, oh my God, you know, it must be so difficult with this iambic pentameter from Elizabethan times and Titus Andronicus, and look at the emotion, look at that, it's so rare. And but we don't have any, we're not allowed to have sex, you know, we're not allowed to taste it, we're not allowed to, so we're spectators of emotion. And we're being trained as actors and directed by directors who say that, who force that concept, that emotion is something that's on the stage. And I've never was interested in that when, as an actor, you know, this whole thing, well, why do I have to go through this whole thing, and it's uncomfortable and it's hard, and why is it not fun, you know? And until I understood that, emotion doesn't belong on stage at all. It belongs in the room. That's where the emotion is. And we have to work to move people. And that's a completely different game. And it's a much, I'm not saying it's easier, but it's much more, it's less masturbatory. It doesn't sound good when I say that in English, right? But it's less.
Good to me.
It's good to you. No, but I mean, it's less. You know, let's do it here. It's more generous. It's more, and the audience is more. The audience is included in the equation, and it feels involved, and it feels, you know, and instead of just looking at people, feel, and you go, oh, what a great actor. Yeah. So, and you could be moved as a spectator without the actors being moved. Even if they're talking about, you know, their child was killed during the war or whatever, but what's important is to for the emotion to be in the room, and the survival of theater as an art form depends on that, and on nothing else. And we are wrongly directed, and we've been wrongly directed for a long time in the theater to think the other way around, to think an actor has to emote, and the actor has to feel. Well, yeah, that's interesting. That's one way that I could, if you have the right project, and maybe that's one path into a certain kind of theater. And I had this extraordinary revelation 4 years ago, I'd say. I was working on a Hamlet, a one-man Hamlet, with Evgeny Mironov, who's probably the greatest Russian actor, who's in his mid-40s. No, not true. We just celebrated his 50th anniversary, so he's 50 now. Well, he was in his mid-40s when I worked with him. And he's this extraordinary, extraordinary Russian actor in Moscow, and who comes from the long tradition of Stanislavski. And I would cringe when I would hear the word Stanislavski before. I go, oh my God, you know, actor, you know, method acting and whatever that became, in naturalism and psychology. You know, I would just kind of, not that I'm not interested in these forms, but what I'm saying is that I would always be bored. And of course, here I was working with this great flagship of Stanislavskian approach, and I said to him, and we were doing this Hamlet thing, and I said, well, I don't approach Shakespeare in a Stanislavski way. I just want to warn you, you're going to be very disappointed with me. And he said, that's because you don't know Stanislavski. I said, yeah, I've been trained, and I've done my workshops, and I did the whole method acting thing. I did all the workshops. He says, yeah, but you people in America and in Western Europe do not know what Stanislavski is about. And he said, you only know the first part of his life. But then when the communists came around, there was a second part of his life, and he said that's where Stanislavski got really interested in experimental and pushed it really, really far. And that part is not, we're still kind of teaching to our students the first part of Stanislavski's discoveries. So he said, I'll reconcile you with Stanislavski. And he did. And what this actor does, and so well, and he does this whole Stanislavski thing, but it's the most generous, creative, non-masturbatory thing. He's completely in a second state. He's in the character, but he has this eye where he really checks the audience and makes sure that they get this subtle double message, and his body contradicts what he's actually saying, and he does all these amazing things. And he's completely connected to the room. He and the emotion is in the room. And when you interrupt him during a line where he's in this complete second state, he just pops up and says, what? He doesn't do, you know. He's an amazing technician. And he's creative. And so he, like, and that, for me, that was a revelation because, we think we know about what acting means, and we, of course, and it's great, and we have to believe all the great masters and the people who've done all this amazing experimenting for us and all that, but it's not being taught very well. It's ill-informed. So, anyways, all this to say that kind of confirmed for me this thing that the emotion has to be over there, because the way the good Russian actors, the good Stanislavski Russian actors use that method is really to tell a story.
I guess it's also why we like to look at puppets or Kleist's idea about puppets and actors, but also Japanese theater with masks. I know you have been influenced, right, by Asian theater?
Yeah, mainly Japanese. I spent most of the 90s, I'd go to Japan at least twice a year to present my shows, but also to do workshops with Japanese actors. And before the Globe was constructed or reconstructed in London, Tokyo had its own Tokyo Globe. They had reproduced the Globe. Of course, it was called the Panasonic Tokyo Globe. but it was fantastic because they would only present Shakespeare, Japanese Shakespeare productions, but mainly they would invite all of the most interesting directors around the world. Cheek by Jowl would be there all the time, some productions from the National or the RSC. But of course, because it was exactly the dimension of the Shakespeare's Globe, some productions could not make it because there was not enough space for it. But so there was this extraordinary, I saw some Ingmar Bergman plays there. I mean, it was a really, really amazing place. And what struck me about the Japanese culture in general, but also the theatrical tradition, whether it's avant-garde theater or traditional theater in Japan, is that it's very baroque, it's very permissive, it's very playful. It has all the things that why I wanted to do theater, and I could find that in Japanese theater. So let's say we do The Tempest. So we will try to work very hard. We'll audition actors, and we'll want the girl who plays Miranda to be a believable daughter for the Prospero that we've chosen, and we want everybody to be speaking the language the same way. I mean, if we have time and money, we will want everybody to be. We'll have a good Shakespeare coach who will come and explain how to use the pentameter and the text, and we will want everybody on that stage to look as if they come from the same theater school, right? If we do Three Sisters, we want the Three Sisters to give the impression that they're three real sisters, right? That's what we do in the West. They do the opposite. You do The Tempest, the people playing the court will be actors from the kabuki who have a certain way of doing. You have a kind of a sprite or a fairy or like Ariel would be somebody from the Kyogen tradition. the lovers would be what they call Western style actors. And for them, that's rich. And what we do, I mean, they're interested in what we do, but it's a bit boring because it's like one thing. For them, it's like a bento box, you know? There's a bit of this and a bit of that. And that for me was so liberating. I went, my God, why does it work? We would do this and it would be a mess, you know? So how do you make it work? So I got interested in that aspect of Japanese theater and saw how rich it is and how permissive. And even in the most traditional kabuki piece, there's that crazy Baroque thing that goes on that's still present today. And I'm sure they're probably very auto-critical about that, and they probably feel that that's gone away or whatever. But when I go to Tokyo, I go to Kabukiza, and I see these reproductions of stagings of a piece like from like 100 or 200 years ago, and it's full of creativity, and there's never any fourth wall. You walk in, you could actually speak during the show, and you could eat, and the lights are open, because what's on stage is so over the top, it's so larger than life, it's so colorful. You will never disrupt that. You will never have an actor that goes, can you please shut up, please, I'm trying to concentrate. They don't say a word until you scream their name, because they have this thing, like in a sports event, you scream the actor's acting family name. And the more it's difficult for the person to act, the more he needs the audience to scream that at him. It's extraordinary. It's an extraordinary, permissive, eventful, playful thing that we've killed, that we've drowned in schmaltz and all these in the West. I mean, so I don't have the pretension to be able to do that as well, but I'm certainly influenced by that, and I'm interested in that aspect of Japanese theater.
It is true though, the stage mechanisms and doors that opens and slides and things, and it's not a big surprise that someone in the middle of the play who's dead would get up and do a song and then is dead again. All these things we have a hard time to believe. Speaking of larger than life or big things, we showed the documentary in the afternoon about the image mill. There's a big, if I saw it right, a big industrial building at the port of Quebec that actually stands in between you and the view of the ships that come in and to the harbor, and which actually is an image of archival image of the world, and you said we should actually see them, and you can't. And then you said, let's do a projection. So he did a projection of 500 meter times 50 meters high with third element, the most complex thing I have ever seen to be putting up. And so you projected something on the city, but now you created this this Le Diamant, where a diamond, as you said before, a diamond is a diamond because actually more light comes out than gets in. That's why when it's cut right, mm-hmm. and it has to lose sometimes two-thirds of its weight to do through. But your projection of the Diamant on the city as a piece of art or an artwork, what is your vision for that?
Well, actually, Le Diamant is a project that will hopefully open its doors in 2 years from now. It's been quite a complex technical and financial endeavor, but it's now officially going to happen. So we're building this space, and it's called Le Diamant, well, parts for the reasons you were. It's also because Quebec City was founded on a cape that is called Cape Diamond, because when the French first explored Canada, they came and they stopped there because they thought there were diamonds in the cape, but actually it was just like cheap minerals. They regretted it, but it was still, you know, it's still called Cape Diamond. So that was part of it. But also, because in 1997, when we opened our first center called La Caserne in Quebec City, it's an old fire hall that became our kind of incubator where we do all our stuff and we develop our shows and all that. we had people from all over the world, friends and people we've collaborated with, or actors or whatever, who would send videos to say good luck for your center. And Bob Wilson sent us this very nice clip of him who says, in a very Bob Wilson fashion, to Robert Lepage for his center. Our cities need centers, a diamond and an apple. So, which was a very Bob Wilson thing, of course, to say. So I went, oh, a diamond and an apple. That's a nice image, you know. The city is the apple and the diamond is, okay.
I think it was his final work at Pratt Institute when he studied as a student.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, well, the thing is that image of a diamond and an apple kind of grew on me. And I thought, okay, at first it is a cultural center, which is a very, very bright, luminous thing in the middle of a city. But then the diamond is an interesting metaphor also for the different facets that you were describing, this different discipline. I mean, to do theater is supposed to be a gathering place, supposed to be the gathering of all other disciplines. You know, people who are into architecture can end up doing participating to theater, music, the people from the world of literature, the people of who work with dance, etc., etc. So all arts can actually converge towards theater. Theater is a great mother art, let's say. So the diamond has that kind of idea of there's different facets and all of these things shine each other. But it's also, if you push it further, a diamond in its first expression is a very, very rough thing before you polish it and all that. And a few months ago, I was invited. I train at a gym where there's this big buff guy who's a prison guard, you know, who never spoke to me for about a year. And which is a big guy on steroids. And he walks in. At one point, he came and says, "Hey, Robert." So I'm surprised he knows my name. So I say, "Yeah." He says, "I'd really like you to come and see me fight. I'm a wrestler, and I'm the champion." And he's a champion of this North Shore division or something like that. And he said, "We're having a pro wrestling match in Quebec City in this kind of hall or whatever." And I said, "I'd like you to come and see me wrestle." I said, "Okay." So a bunch of people from Ex Machina, you know, artsy fartsy people, we're all going to go, "We're going to go see some wrestlers." And we sit there, and it was this amazing evening in the theater. It was the greatest thing. And it was reminded me, you know, my first impressions of Japanese theater, this kind of raw, popular, loud, larger than life characters that predetermined, pre-written, but completely improvised. All of the great emotions and the great heroes and foes are, and they put on costumes like Peter Gabriel and all these people. And this is it's an extraordinary theatrical evening, you know, this wrestling match. And of course, with it, you know, and all its clumsiness and all its, and I went, this has to be at the Diamond, side by side with a Shakespeare show or Castellucci show, whatever. It has to be side by side. It has to be, and also because the audience that's there, there is no fourth wall, and people are standing up and they're screaming filth at the people, and there's all this stuff going on. Of course, it's very rough, but there's luminous moments. There's acrobatics, there's art, there's theater, there's even music. Everybody has their theme when they walk in. There's this whole thing that goes on, you know, and so anyways, I was so impressed that I went back to Ex Machina and I said, "Well, listen, because at the Diamond we're going to have circus artists, we're going to have dance, we're going to have, you know, it's going to be a pluridisciplinary place where all these people are going to be working together and showing their stuff in the different rooms and all that, but there has to be wrestling also." So everybody went, "Are you serious?" You know. And I say, "Yeah, that's what was missing, the unpolished thing. And also the audience that comes with that. It has to be, the Diamond has to be a place where all audiences have to be." Of course, people start to scratch their heads. How do you make, financially, how do you make this work? You know, and people are not used to going to that part of town, and if they have to pay for parking, what are we going to do? So and we're kind of reflecting on all of that. But
wrestling might help.
Well, probably. But it's and for me it became, you know, we really have to. So anyways, I go to see this guy. This guy, I never actually got to know his real name, but his stage name is Marco Estrada. Of course, and he's a Quebecois guy, you know. It's nothing to do with it, but it's Marco with a K, anyways. So I go to see Marco in the dressing room at the gym, and I say, hey, I really enjoyed your show the other day, and I'm bragging. I'm saying, oh, that was fantastic, and all that. And I said, well, and I'm doing a new one-man show that I've been, that's what I'm going to be doing at BAM. It's called 887. And I was actually performing in Quebec City at that moment, this new one-man show. So I said, I'll get you a pair of tickets, you know, if you want to come with your girlfriend or whatever and come see my show. So you could see, you know, I saw what you do and you could see what I do. It's, oh, yeah, I'd be very interested in all that. So anyways, he shows up with a guy who's twice as big as him, this big guy. And they come see the show, and they're flabbergasted, and they loved it, and they were moved. And we're in the dressing room after the show, and we're talking and all that. And I'm, you know, really happy and moved that they've liked it and all that. But they were wrestling that evening, and so they came to see the matinee. At one point, they go, oh, I have to go because, you know, we're wrestling together. He says, he's my nemesis. And he was actually, he was with his best friend who, on stage, in the ring, is his worst enemy. And it was so amazing. And I just went, my God, this is a world I want to know about. Because also, one of the conditions, because, you know, to be an astronaut, they do all these tests. You have to be fearless, right? There has to be something in your brain that's missing. Because, you know, you're in a tin can, and you're running out of fuel, and you have to land on the moon, and you just stay very calm and say, okay, we'll do this. Okay, fine, thank you, we're here. You know, you have to be, so that part of your brain has to be non-existent. So it's the same thing for wrestling. For wrestling, you have to be non-aggressive. The people who wrestle, the people who end up being the champions, the people who are the sweetest, peaceful, non-aggressive people, because you can't, if you're aggressive, you know, you can't be in a saying, okay, well, tonight, give me a kick me here and I'll do a pirouette and then I'll do that. And then you break his nose, you know, the guy's who's going to. So that's one of the basic conditions. You can only be part of the team if you don't have a single speck of violence or aggression. And I want to know what these people are about. You know, it just completely intrigues me. So anyway, it's a very long digression to say that's the diamond for me is a meeting point, a meeting place for that kind of encounter.
Yeah, and that we, you know each other, worlds that don't normally connect, and that you can live out aggressive. Mm-hmm. Impulses and energy on a stage, but mm-hmm. in a civil way. Why we have theater in a city, because we think it's important, in a way goes back to Athens and Greek theater. That's why we have it, where we think a civilized country and city has this theater. And that was, you know, the audience was higher, the temples, actually the gods were in the temple while you were performing, and the actors spoke through them. They actually were facing not each other, they were facing the gods, and you saw often the city of Athens or the other city in the background. But it has a civic function beyond that. What do you see? What difference, you know, besides that you say we show different things, but do you expect from it that the city of Quebec will be a different city?
Well, yes, I think so. But I'm more interested in trying to model that place for what the function of theater will be, and it's very pretentious what I'm saying, but anyways, it will be in the 21st century.
You're building a new Athens, you know, in
well,
a way.
No,
yeah.
Not
what,
a new
what's your
Athens,
idea? What is your vision?
Okay, yeah. It's because, okay, and I'm sure a lot of people will disagree, but you will agree with me one day. It's that theater can only survive if it's an event. All of the, most of theater people and theater companies and theater producers and all that are working really hard to make it a habit, right? they want you to subscribe. They want you to be there. There, a lot of the theater is being said, come to see us, you will be entertained. You'll forget about your problems. It's all, the promo is all about, come to see us and nothing will happen, right? And, but that's what's burying theater. People go to the theater if it's something you have to see. People pay $1,500 to see Hamilton because supposedly it's the thing, and people do it. It's the event, right? So theater has to be an event, and also so shapes and forms. It doesn't need to be Hamilton, but I mean, it has to be eventful. Certainly in a world where storytellers are all over the place and the offer is so huge, why, if I have a home cinema, a high definition, Netflix offers me whatever I want to see when I want, doesn't cost me much, I don't have to pay for a parking lot, don't have to make reservations in a restaurant, don't have to pay for a babysitter, don't have to dress up, anyway, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm going to stay home tonight. I'm not going to go see, you know, Three Sisters. I'm not going to go see the new play by this new Irish writer that's supposed to be amazing. I'm going to stay home. So what is going to, who's going to pull these people out and bring them to the theater and say it's important? So theater has to be an event. Otherwise, if you have the choice, you're going to stay home. That's more and more. So, I mean, I know some people would disagree with me, but that's what I feel. And I do a lot of projects, and I do a lot of shows, and I do circus shows, and I do plays, and I do all sorts of stuff. And I think I'm starting to know enough about what today's audience is about and what makes them tick and where they're ready to embark into something that they've never been on, and when they are looking for comfort and, you know, so I'm starting to get a sense of that, and I have the impression theater only works when it's eventful, when it's an event, when people say, I can't miss this, I have to be there, I have to go. And there's a comfort zone also. People want to be, they don't want to be entertained. They want to feel intelligent. They want to embark into something that will be playful and where they will feel that they can actually participate, even if it doesn't mean to be, you know, I have to be there and I have to ask questions. I mean, if you have the impression that you're connecting the dots and that what you're seeing is not masticated for you, it's not tasted for you before it's given to you. If you go there and you have the impression that it could only happen if you're there for real and if the show needs you. If you understand all these things, theater becomes exciting and fun and eventful and people go to see it and it works. But if it's sold like something that will put you to sleep and relax you or massage you and all that, it's going to kill the craft, you know. And it's urgent because people have their own devices and they have access to so many storytellers on YouTube now, and so if you still want to find the purpose of theater, you have to reflect about then why would I personally go to see a show tonight? What is it about it? So you have to go back to the idea that theater is also a sport, right? There's something that there has to be a ball there that might fall, that people, the actors might drop the ball, and that's something risky and anyways, I could go on and ever and forever and ever about this, but I have the impression that there's very few people who really reflect about that, the survival of our companies, our theater companies, our craft, our traditions, the future of theater, where it should go. We're busy running businesses, you know, so, and we're not good at it anyways.
I wish you would be in charge of one of the many new spaces that are being built at the moment in New York City, but I fear they might be more on the sleepwalking part. But speaking of participation and opening it up, maybe Brad and Michael, maybe we have a bit of light on the audience. We take some audience questions, which is important for us, but also Robert Lepage, please make sure there is a dialogue. So if you have some comments, like 1, 2, and 3. So we'll four. Okay, we'll start with you. We are recording. Not only we hear you better. Supposedly after 20 minutes, it's always good. It's a little bit reinforced, but we are recording it and live streaming it. So that's hold it close and
so
say maybe who you are.
You have to sign a release after your question.
Yeah.
This man will vouch for me. Firstly, I very much appreciate everything that you've done. You're being in New York as a Quebecer, a Montrealer. I run the Council for Canadian-American Relations, and we're all about facilitating cross-border collaboration and supporting artistic organizations in both countries. So thank you. I wanted to ask if you had any reflections, had been inspired by, or had any collaborations with another Quebec artist who passed away last week, Leonard Cohen, who is someone that when you spoke about everything that you did that was so rich and all the diverse art forms, to me, many of the themes resonate in his work as well, that with words convey or emote, yeah, so much. And I was curious as to whether there had been...
Well, I never got to meet him, but I got to spend a bit of time with his son, Adam, who at one point had the project of doing a theater project about Leonard Cohen's, not just life, but work in general. That. So we had a few discussions. Of course, I wasn't available enough to actually bring it to fruition. But certainly I was very interested in Leonard Cohen's work. And of course, I'm from that generation that has listened to a lot of his work and identified a lot to it, because he had this identity thing, being a Quebecer, a Montrealer, but being an Anglo and a Jewish guy, and this whole kind of, and how you make that resonate in the world and in world culture. So of course he was a great inspiration, that's for sure. But I never got to meet him.
Thank you. I would like to come back on what you said about the emotion on the room. As a director, how do you build the emotion for the audience?
Mm-hmm. Well, as I said, there's something about the playfulness. Something for me, I'm a bit obsessed with this idea that the theater, even if we're doing a Greek tragedy or we're doing a psychological drama, things have to be playful. And I think that if the audience is engaged in a story, you're telling the story, and as I said earlier, if you don't connect all the dots for them, if you just put the dots there and all that, the actual action is the way people listen. And they become very involved emotionally. They do their own connections, and then they refer to stuff that is very personal that they can't really share. But so, and all of that process usually moves people, because they are involved in the thinking process and the building of the story. And for that, you have to create something that is very, very emotionally sparse. I don't know how to explain that. You should not cry for the people in the room. You have to reproduce on stage the energy of an emotion, but you don't necessarily need to be emotional. Of course, an actor can be emotional and be caught in the emotion of the moment and all that. But I think that's what, it's difficult to explain it directly, but that's for me was one of the things about Bertolt Brecht's. People always thought that his, I think you call it alienation in English. In French, it's horribly translated as distanciation, distanciation, which makes it even sound even colder and all that. When it's in oh my God, there's a German person here.
Entfremdungseffekt,
which is the effect of making something strange, right? So
unfamiliar,
yeah. But it is a very, very warm process, this idea of making something unfamiliar and strange, and distanciation creates a distance, so it sounds as if it's a cold intellectual process. But I think that I always, for example, when I'm doing L'Amour de Loin, I'm working with this amazing singer, Susanna Phillips, an amazing soprano, who's a great actor also. And she's approached a role, she did all her research and all that, and she's been working on the psychology of her character and all that. And the music just doesn't come out, you know, in the first rehearsals. And she's wondering because she did all this work. But I say, don't try to make it psychological. The emotion is poetic. It's full of poetic license, and it's full of, and for her that kind of changed her approach. And since then, she's been doing the most amazing, moving things. But of course, she's a technician; she has to sing on the right pitch and the right. So it's all this kind of thing, and she writes it as she goes on, and she becomes the writer of the music, the writer of the libretto, and. That's always been my thing, that's why I'm interested in collective creation, is that I believe that if acting is to pretend that you are actually writing the words, why not write the words? Why not ask an actor, what would you say? How would you write it? Or what is it that you need to say? So that's a very, very different energy in the room when you have people who are sincere and people are authentic, that creates a presence that is a very, very moving thing. But instead of finding people who are natural, naturalism or psychologically motivated, and they go into this whole thing. And so it's difficult to explain, but my approach is more, it's a playful, poetic approach. And when I was saying that I had this illumination when I worked with Evgeny in Moscow 4 years ago, was that's what it was. He had nothing to do with psychology, what he was doing. But he was in a state. He had the energy of the situation, the character in that situation, and it was like really. But he was using the poetry of Shakespeare and the poetry of the stage language and the movement and all that to express, and that is much more moving. And what he was doing was authentic. And that's always very, very, very moving when you're in the presence of something that's authentic. I don't know how to describe it better, but.
Thank you much for sharing with us. I'm much an admirer of your work. The two films that we saw today, two quick questions. One is for the triptych, a color question. Because it seems so much brown and the sepias, and occasionally there was, like it seems the Christmas scene of the old things where there's blue and red. So it's a color, if you've had a conscious work with that. And the other is with the Moulin à Image, you had said that there was no storyboard. And I'm very interested in the idea of narration, you know, the thread. You know, obviously you had a plan where you're going, but the difference between the storyboard and a narration, if there was one, of the Moulin à Image.
Yeah, well, for the Moulin Image, but also for other works, we did a 9-hour show called Lip Sync, and Seven Stream of the River Utas was a 7-hour show, and we never tried to write a story from A to Z. We rehearse, we do all these things, we do improvs and all that, and suddenly there's a little pocket of a story that appears. Okay, well, this is going to be in the show. And then we continue, and then there's another little pocket. And eventually all these little jewels or these little things appear. And eventually they find their place. It's almost like doing a recital and you're looking for the, how do they call that? What the bands call it? A set list? You have your set list. You go, well, last night we tried this song before this one. It was a bit of a downer. Well, let's put it here instead. So that's how the structure is done, and it's often done in front of the audience. So for us, day one of the performance is not the guillotine of an opening. It's not, and from now on, this is the show. It's from now on, the real writing and structuring happens. So of course, you know, the early audience members don't necessarily see they see an interesting show, but it's never as interesting and well-crafted as if they see it like a 50 or 100 performances later. So that's pretty much how the structure, it finds itself, I'd say. And during that process, there's something that I call it a bottomless well, is that let's say, a group of actors here. We'd start improvising, whatever. And so it's a restaurant scene. We need a couple, and we need a waiter. So it's okay, you do the waiter, you do the wife, you'll do the husband, and we do that. And then after that, we do it again, with, but this time you do the husband, you do the waitress, and you do the friend of the guy. Okay. And then we do it again. And then everybody changes all the time. And eventually, you end up playing a character you never that's not in your casting. Usually you're never casted for this kind of thing, but you do it. And you discover that you're a bottomless, it's a bottomless well. It's a character that you could improv for 1,000 years and you'd never run out. But because we're being casted, you know, you do the mother, you'll play the kid because you're, you know, and you look like the father, so you play the father. But in this, what we do is that we just change all the time and there's no real kind of casting. And eventually you end up performing something you never thought you'd be able to do. And it's bottomless. It's just, you could, and because some characters you could do and maybe after 5 minutes you've run out of. But this one is forever. So we say, okay, we have a bottomless well and we sit this guy's in the show. You know, we don't know what's his relationship with the story. We don't know what's his relationship with the other characters. But we do that. And eventually all these bottomless wells appear. They pop up and we know these guys are the people who will be following. They'll be the main characters. Probably, and eventually they are related. You know, we start to find, oh, this one actually could be married to this one, or this one's actually this guy's brother, or this guy is his boss, or whatever. And anyway, so this whole thing kind of builds, but you have these characters that belong specifically to that actor, and that are, it doesn't sound good in English, bottomless, but sorry. But what I mean is that there's no end to what you could do. So we could improv them forever. So then when we start performing, the night of the opening, these characters are there and they're really interesting and they draw you in and they're, but they keep evolving and they can adapt. So we decide, we rewrite the show that this scene goes there and this one's changes purpose or whatever. These characters adapt to anything. They're like pieces of the puzzle that could be placed anywhere because they're like full of resources, and so that's pretty much what I try to. Once again, you can't command that, you can't order that. It happens, and you have to have an eye for it and an ear for it, and you have to go, oh, I think this, okay, this guy's going to come back for sure, and eventually you. And as for the color question, the first color question, I don't know what to answer because it was my director of photography who made all these choices. But I don't have any real kind of, I approved because I thought it was cool, but I didn't have any kind of an intent or.
Hi, I have a question about the diamond. I think your idea of it being pluridisciplinary, both artistically but sort of beyond artistic means, is very exciting and unique. Frank mentioned that there's a couple of key big art centers opening up here in New York, and I'm wondering if in your plans for Le Diamant, if you plan to have any particular relationships with other art centers in New York or other cities, you know, maybe similar to the way that's kind of more of a European model and having those kinds of.
Yeah, of course. Well, that's part of the whole plan. And of course, the idea is for it to be an international meeting point for, you know, theater craftsmen and performers and thinkers. And of course, that's the idea. But the thing is that the actual form of the place, the shape, the architectural project of the Diamant, is also part of the thing, in the sense that we wanted to be able to greet all kinds of shapes and forms. And there's something about, because we never really discussed it, but there's, you know, it used to be that the film world would be one thing and the theater world would be another. Of course, now with interactive videos and people using new technology and recorded image and sound, all that more and more in the theater, these disciplines seem to kind of be merging. And the reason why is because the technology that they use starts to be similar. So basically, there's a lot of disciplines who don't mix because the technologies that they use are so different. But the more the digital age and the tools start to be the same, the more it's easy for them. So it's the same thing for spaces. So we're trying to design a space, a performance space, that will greet vertical projects and horizontal projects. So what I mean is that the film world and television and all that is a horizontal thing, right? And opera and circus is a vertical thing. So how do you make these things meet? You know, so I end up doing tours, certainly in North America. I do plays in rooms that were used to be cinemas. So you're in this kind of horizontal space. And then we go on tour in Europe, and there's all these vertical things because you play in old opera houses or whatever. So for me, it's very important because it doesn't just have to do with the shape and the form of the frame. It has to do with the nature of the art itself. Opera and circus are stories that are told vertically, right? There's the stage and this man, and then you have all his aspirations coming from the flies or whatever. That's what he wants to become. And then you have all the traps that, you know, when you fall into hell. Right, so the story is often said like that. But film is about road movies, it's about panning like this. Of course, you know, he does some things going on like this a lot, but it's a lot about man and his territory and whatever. So it's a completely different way. So theater's starting to borrow from that and its storytelling, and cinema is starting to change a bit the shape also. So I have the impression that we're moving towards storytelling that will start to be a hybrid between this horizontal and vertical way of telling stories. Sorry, I just kind of went into the zone, kind of.
Maybe one or two more questions? One and one more? Anybody? Two here. Three. Okay, that's it.
Bonsoir. Could you tell us more about your making of or presenting of L'Amour de Loin at the Met, what your vision is, and convince us to come to it.
I wasn't here necessarily to sell tickets for the Met, but it's an amazing opera. It's tough to find a good contemporary opera. Programmers will tell you that. We also have the impression that they're kind of counting on old 19th century or 18th century stuff because they're sure bets, but actually it's also because the for audiences are resisting, I guess, to contemporary opera for all sorts of reasons. But L'Amour de Loin is one of these rare operas. It was written early in 2000, but it was first produced in the year 2000 in Salzburg. And it is contemporary music, but because it refers, it was all written around this ballad that a troubadour wrote in the 13th century. It's like a take on that medieval piece of music, and Kaija created this amazing contemporary piece of music. And the story is medieval, and it's about this troubadour who falls in love with a woman he never saw, who's in Lebanon, and the woman in Lebanon falls in love with this man because she hears the song that he wrote about her, and there's this pilgrim that just kind of navigates between the two. So it's about this ideal love, the purity of love and the ideal love and all that. And so there's this sea that separates the lovers. So L'Amour de Loin means love from afar, and it's based on a legend because this guy, Geoffrey Rudel, the troubadour, actually existed and supposedly crossed that sea to go and see his loved one and got sick on the boat and traumatized or whatever, and he died in her arms when he arrived. So this is kind of, you know, kind of beautiful, impossible love story. And the sea that separates them is the bulk of the music, you know. So Peter Sellers created it in Salzburg, and his solution was to put water on stage and all that. And it was a very beautiful production and very efficient and all that. But water is a tricky thing if you're going to be at the Met, because it's about 12 shows in the repertoire. And you don't want to have water on your stage. And also because for me, water was too literal. So we've created this sea of LED lights. This is something, I think there's 38,000 LED lights that are out of the sea, and people come in and float among the light, and the lights are shimmering and creating all these amazing sea-like and wave-like effects and all that. And the chorus is under these lights, and they bob their heads through them. And so it's a very beautiful high-tech production of a medieval story. So it's a nice. So it reflects the music. The music is the meeting point of these two ideas.
Hi, my question is also about the Metropolitan Opera, but the previous productions, and I guess everything that you do is computer technology driven. I think what I read about the other productions was one of them had something to do with the backdrop behind the performers changing color or something as they sang, and the other one moving planks. Mm-hmm. Can you give us an idea of how those things worked and what it was all about?
And how they don't work at times.
That's okay. But just, yeah. I didn't see any of the productions. Yeah.
So no, there was one production, Damnation of Faust, which was mainly about how any imagery, any video, any animation or whatever that would accompany the story would be triggered by the artists themselves, the singers, but also by the swell of the orchestra. So you'd have a flock of birds in the background that would be flying, and the birds, their flights would be influenced by the pitch, by the rhythm, the tempis, there was so many elements, but because everything was mic'd in the pit, and that would tell would indicate to the birds, virtual birds, how high to fly, how to gather, how close, how, you know, so it was all these things. So all of the high-tech vocabulary was triggered by singers, and the other thing was this huge monster of a production called The Ring. That was really an experience. But anyways, it was a huge thing with planks. It was 24 planks, kind of creating all these different. We saw a picture of one of the dragon and all that. So it was a very controversial production, because it was presented in front of an audience of a very enthusiastic audience, but part of these people are sitting there with scores, not looking at the stage, and they're going like this, and they're going, oh, you know, they've cut that passage. Oh, she didn't sing this note. And at one point, if you're doing anything on stage and it creaks and cracks or crashes, and they go, my God. There's a production there. We don't want that, you know. This is not opera. There should not be any noise. There should not be any. Anyway, so it was quite an experience. It's 5 years of that, so I'm not sure I'm going to venture into that.
Good. Last question.
Yes, hi, hello. Actually, I'm from Japan, so. And she asked about the already about the machine. That was my initial thought. And actually, it was quite eventful to have that machine on the stage. And I was eager to go and to see everything. And what was your initial idea to have that machine? And could you talk it in like a context of, you know, event and emotion in the room?
Yeah. Well, the concept was very simple, is that we wanted to create 24 planks of a regular stage. You know, we just wanted it to look like a very banal stage, very classic and very, and then that the stage, the planks would, depending of the positions of the plank, that suddenly you would move into a more contemporary vocabulary. But then it implied that it had to be a machine and a monster and, you know, all that. But at the beginning, it was just playing with 24 planks and their positions. It's just that it became a very heavy idea. but everything was programmed and all that. But it was a very, very classical approach. And I don't want to offend anybody here, but most rings that I had seen were what we call Euro trash. I mean, it's just everybody has something, a problem to solve with Wagner, and to, you know, there's always, the people are always doing something, and then I just, you know, if it's my first ring, I'd like it to be about these gods and that mythology, and it's, and a lot of that mythology is actually Icelandic. It's not German at all. It's Icelandic, and I wanted to go back to that and all that. So the idea was to create, and I've been to Iceland. I'm a great fan of Iceland, and the thing that's amazing about Iceland is that it's a, because I studied geology. That was supposed to be my thing before I became a theater person. I was supposed to be a geography teacher or a geologist. So and the thing about the tectonic plates and the thing about Iceland, it's an island. It's a country that is in constant movement. You know, there's volcanoes erupting and there's things sinking, and the actual island is split in two, and it's actually separating six centimeters a year. And so people in Iceland live on a ground that's very unstable. And a lot of the mythology comes from that. So that was the basic thing, to create something, a floor that looks very simple, but if an opera singer walks on it, suddenly it goes. And then, of course, you have to deal with the opera singers. But it's a very good documentary about it that the Met produced, actually. It's quite interesting. You see the whole, it's called Wagner's Dream. So, and that, I must say, because the Wagner Society, because you have to go through all the tests, right, in New York when you do the ring, you have to go through the Wagner Society and all that. And I did a lot of research on how Wagner had intended, what he wanted to do. And of course, the technology wasn't, there's a lot of stuff he wanted to do, and the technology just wasn't there. You know? So that was also part of the pretension of this concept, was to say, well, I think Wagner would have wanted to do this and to do that, and have the actors do this and have that the singer do that and whatever. So there was this whole preamble to the whole concept.
And I think this is also one of the great things about theater, that life is unstable, actually. People try to tell you something is perfect, and mom and dad only play baseball and do cookies and everything is perfect. It's actually not. It's more like Shakespeare. It's more like Wagner. This is normal, and we deal with it, and we look at it and solve our own problems often in life, through whether it's family or political things, through the stories we look at. So, again, you're such a great master, and we gave us a little glimpse of your graft and your brain and the mechanics, how it's working, and about the wrestling. There's a wonderful essay by Roland Barthes about wrestling and how significant and important it is, and also connected to popular culture we all don't take seriously enough, and also the energy that comes from it, and we really all should look at it. Again, I wish we had you here with a big art center, and it's really our hope that Le Diamant might open old trade routes where the fur traders once went back and forth, and we do it with theater for New York companies, and Quebecois Canadian work will come, international work, and we hope maybe we will be a little speck of the little lights within that diamond. We would be thrilled to be connected again. Thank you for coming, and I think he really gave us a wonderful insights. And thank you for taking the time.
It's a great pleasure. Thank you.